Lord, thank you, we're in your presence together. Lord, that means we're in a dynamic place. A place that surpasses, quite frankly, all understanding. But Lord, I ask that this morning you give us understanding, you give us ears to hear, eyes to see, open our minds, open our hearts. In the name of Jesus, amen. Could you turn to Mark chapter 9, starting at verse 30. Mark chapter 9, starting at verse 30. Two weeks ago, we ended with that marvellous concept of relying on God. Clearly, sometimes we fall into the trap of not doing. We get so used to a situation or a set of circumstances, it's, I've been here before, know what I'm doing. I think I entitled it, I've got this one. I got this one, lads. And then discovering that they couldn't cast out this demon out of this boy, didn't figure out why, asked Jesus later on, this one can only be cast out by prayer. Then you try and unpack, well, what did Jesus mean by that? To be honest with you, we all recognise it was a tad cryptic, but I used a bit of artistic license, if you remember, and said maybe what he was saying was, well, as we worked it through, you weren't really relying upon God to make it happen. You'd got used to the idea of casting out demons. You'd done it back in chapter 6. So we're going to move on from that. And we're going to go through this bit by bit. So verse 30. So leaving that region, they travelled through Galilee. Jesus didn't want anyone to know where he was there, for he wanted to spend more time with his disciples and teach them. He said to them, "The Son of Man is going to be betrayed into the hands of his enemies. He will be killed, but 3 days later he will rise from the dead." They didn't understand what he was saying, however, and they were afraid to ask him what he meant. A bit sad of that for now. Again, it's about three times in Mark where Jesus sort of talks about, I'm going to die, 3 days later I'm going to be rose again. And three times disciples pretty much don't get it, which you can understand because this still makes no sense to them. They're following a Messiah, warrior type Messiah, or so they think, and so therefore then they haven't quite picked up that he's got to die. It's part of the process. He's got to die to get victory. And they haven't quite got that. We don't get that at times, that we actually have to die to ourselves to get victory. We actually have to die and recommit our lives to Christ to get victory. Amen. But they didn't quite understand. The Son of Man is a title that Jesus always sort of gave himself, in, especially in the book of Mark. And that's a long-winded explanation as to why he did that. But you don't want to spend the next 4 hours here, do you? Was that yes? Was that? Oh, right, okay, great. Let's start. Joke. That'll be interesting. I'll have to get out lecture notes. Kevin, come up. But he's going to be betrayed into the hands. And notice again that actually Jesus didn't want people to know where he was there because he wants to spend one-to-one moments with his disciples. He actually wants to teach them more intensely now. Why? Because Jesus knows the time is coming that he's going to die on the cross. His time on this earth as such is very close at hand. So he really needs to get some things into the disciples. He really wants to teach them some new things. Excuse me. But as like some of my lecturers getting my degree, they heard the teacher, just didn't quite understand. And then were also too afraid to ask. Now, have you ever thought, why were they afraid to ask Jesus? I mean, we were singing songs earlier. What a friend I have. No, I'm not going to sing it. What a friend we have in Jesus. He's a friend. Why would you be afraid to ask a friend? Have you ever thought about why they were afraid? Anybody got any answers? Oh, hang on. Oh, yeah, I've got lots. Sorry, I don't have the right microphone. Go, I'll repeat.
I think it was because you're quite an authoritative figure. So maybe they felt that they couldn't easily approach him to ask whatever he'd said. And also I think there were a lot of things going on, so maybe they just didn't feel that they could do that.
Okay, thank you very much. So he was an authoritative figure, and they felt they couldn't quite approach him on that. Come back to you in a moment, Kevin.
Perhaps they were frightened of the answer.
Sorry, we're waiting. It's getting there. Yeah.
Perhaps they were frightened of the answer. They didn't want to know, really.
Frightened of the answer, didn't want to know, really. Absolutely. Back to Kevin. Sorry, it's just my way of getting exercise.
Maybe a lot of them were used to funneling their questions through Peter, and Peter had been smacked badly recently and wasn't in the mood to ask many questions.
Very true, absolutely, yeah. Did you get that idea? Okay, let me explain that to you as best as I quickly. Peter, in the book of Mark, the assumption is that Mark wrote stories from Peter. It's Peter's story of what actually occurred. It's at this point what you're going to have is that Peter normally did a lot of the asking of the questions of Jesus. So it's almost like the disciples went, "Here, Pete, ask him this." You know what I mean? And Peter go, "Yeah, all right then." And not as bust the guts did and didn't sort of go, "Hang on, let me think about this for a minute. Hang on a minute, lads." and so therefore then maybe this time, because Peter had recently been a little bit blasted earlier on in the chapters, maybe even he was a little bit timid in thinking, maybe I shouldn't be asking.
If this is the second or third time Jesus has said it, then maybe they didn't want to ask because they look a bit of a fool. They should have understood that either in front of him, but also, did they know everybody else had got the same question? Didn't they not want to look a fool in front of their other disciple friends?
Yeah, very true. It's another good one.
I was going to say what somebody else
said. Okay. It's interesting for me. Is this being afraid? I like that with Denzel. I always make, if you've ever been to a discussion group or you're a part of the house group that I lead, etc., I have a rule. It's a very simple rule. No question is too stupid. If you're thinking it, guaranteed somebody else in the room is thinking it. Mm-hmm. Unless, of course, you want to ask about what I had for dinner that evening. But the point is that actually here there is an element of that. I like the idea that, yes, Jesus is an authoritative figure. Sometimes it is scary to go up to an authoritative figure and ask them the question. And other times you don't want to ask the question because you don't want the answer. Because it might mean you've got to change your life. That's why we don't ask. I bet sometimes we don't bother asking God about a situation because we really don't want to hear the answer. Because God might be saying, well, it means changing of your life. Shift. It was multiple. One other commentator I remember reading about stated, you know, it was maybe this point, Peter had been lambasted, you know, not so much Peter, but the disciples had been earlier on, a bit of a telling off from Jesus. Maybe a little bit like, I keep asking, I keep getting told off. Why are we not getting it? Are we stupid? So they didn't ask. But they're still on a journey. So they're going through Galilee. Let's carry on. Verse 33 to 37. After they arrived at Capernaum, they settled in a house. Jesus asked his disciples, "What were you discussing out on the road?" But they didn't answer because they had been arguing about which of them was the greatest. He sat down, called the 12 disciples over to him and said, "Whoever wants to be first must take last place and be the servant of everyone else." Then he put a little child among them. Taking the child in his arms, he said to them, "Anyone who welcomes a little child like this on my behalf welcomes me. And anyone who welcomes me welcomes not only me, but also my Father who sent me." So they're still on a journey. They get to this house. They're probably getting on with setting things up, getting themselves settled down. Would have been the disciples' role normally to make sure everything's resolved, food is in and hospitality's sorted. And then you get Jesus going, "What were you chatting about on the road?" Now, just a bit of artistic license. Try and think yourself on that road with Jesus. Try and be an outside observer. And you can see Jesus sort of leading the way, guiding where they're going. And I got an idea of the sort of apostles somewhere at the back. "Who's the greatest? Yeah, I don't know about where you mean. Yeah." And you can imagine Jesus walking in front, can probably overhear them, really. In reality, he probably did know, or heard them at least having a heated debate. And probably thought, "Oh, really? I'll sort that out later." Ever thought like that? Ever read it like that? I think sometimes Jesus must have thought, "Let them get the steam out of their debate, and then I'll have a proper chat with them later." You ever seen a major argument going on? And you think, "Shall I intervene now?" And sometimes you think, "No, actually, let you get your steam out of your system." And when you've calmed your emotions down, when it's slightly better at the moment, we'll ask you some key questions. That's what I liked about Jesus. His timing was pretty good, wasn't it? Yeah? Notice that he probably listened to the Father a lot. About when was about the right time now to ask a key question? We humans have this habit, unfortunately, of jumping in with both feet and our whole body and doing a Peter and going blah into situations where sometimes God is saying, "Let it simmer down, let it pan out a little bit, wait for a minute, then the ground might be a little bit fertile for them to receive what you're about to say and ask." Ever been there? Or was it just me? Am I the only one who sometimes just jumps in when I shouldn't do? Huh? Oh, come on. We're going to have any honesty here today?
We all do it.
Yeah, we all do it. Thank you. What, mother? Oh, okay. I'm now in trouble for pointing out my mum. Here we go. Can we wipe that from the video, please? But I just got this imagery of the disciples, moan, chat, who's the greatest? And we're going to look at them in a minute about what do they mean by who's the greatest. What really kicked that off? But you can imagine that, moan. Anybody done that? Sat there? How many times do you think God's probably sat there gone, "Really? Really? Give me a break. Come on. Sort it out. You should know better by now." And then you can be sitting there in prayer or reading the Bible and suddenly something comes and leaps out of you. There's a key question just at the right moment. And you think, "Oh yeah." And then you don't want to talk to God about it because you know how daft you've been. You come to afraid because God, strangely enough, is an authoritative figure. But actually, when God asks you those key questions, it's because he wants to sort it out with you. He wants to discuss it around with you, bring you to a point of realization that you're wrong, but that's okay. Here's the right answer. Anyway, they're talking about who is the greatest. Could you imagine walking along going, name off some of the disciples who are going to go, well, I'm the greatest. Me. Now, how does that come about? Well, I'd like us to think back a moment. There was a moment that happened on top of a mountain, which involved two other disciples, yes? And they saw Moses and Elijah, and they heard God's voice. Whoa, big moment. Big moment. And yes, dear old Peter, was a tad... We'll build some tents for you now. But then coming down the mountain, Jesus says, by the way, don't say anything about this event until after risen again. They still have no idea what he means. And they walk straight into the argument to do with the boy and casting out the demons, and they go on a journey. Now, do not tell me that has not affected those disciples' thinking. You've just been in a great moment like that. That's going to affect your thinking, isn't it? About who am I to God? Why did I get chosen to go up with Jesus and have that moment? Ooh, am I a bit special? Yeah? And that starts thinking and ticking under their brains for days on end. And maybe for the other disciples who didn't go up the mountain, though they didn't know what happened, but Jesus did say, come with me up the mountain, and left the others. How would you feel if that had happened? Let's just try and think that for a minute. Imagine you're the ones down the mountain, and... Okay, Queen Elizabeth II has invited a couple of us from Greenford Baptist Church, not necessarily me, but a couple from Greenford Baptist Church to go to the palace to have an intimate dinner time with her and Philip. It's Philip she's married to, and I've got that right. Good, making sure. If you're honest, how would you actually feel? And bearing in mind, those two people come back and have not said a word about what has happened because they've been told not to. And you can tell they clearly had an interesting time. How would you actually be feeling? And be honest.
What makes them so special?
Yeah.
Jealous and very envious.
Jealous and very envious. Anybody else? I mean, there could be some positive reactions as well. You are allowed them. It's okay. Listen, I know I went to my next door neighbour's fantastic event last night where I ate some fantastic Nepalese.
I would be thinking, what's wrong with me? Why didn't I go?
Ah, what's wrong with me? Why didn't I go? Anybody else?
The Queen has got enough room for us to all go.
Ah, the Queen's got enough room for us to all go. Yeah. Very good. Don't get some bad habits just because you're sitting next to my mum. Seriously, really. Right?
You'd be enlightened because you'd had a curiosity of what went on in the palace for years. So you'd be quite enlightened to have been there to find out some of the things that transpired in there.
Yeah, but you couldn't say anything.
Also, we'll let people know that we've got people from our church go to see the Queen. Maybe they want to know who's been there, and probably curiosity will bring them back here.
Yeah? Okay, good point. See some good positive spins on that. Sorry?
feet.
Seen you've been stitched up by your sparring partner. What?
I said intrigued.
You'd be intrigued?
Yes.
You'd really want to know, wouldn't you?
Yeah.
What was said? What did she say?
Especially when they're not saying anything. What really went on there?
Yeah, not saying anything. It starts getting to, if you think about it, now think that over a long period of a walk you're spending, breakfast, lunch, dinner, with these guys, yeah? And they're not saying anything. And especially Peter, I mean, Peter almost, wah! But he's not saying anything. And of course, there's the other disciple, who's Jesus' beloved disciple, who always rests on Jesus' chest. Handbags. If you don't understand what that phrasing means, come back to me later on. It's an old phrasing. That means, oh, really? But you see the point. And after days, that starts getting. Now, imagine all the two disciples have been up there. Think about what you'll be thinking coming down and then walking with the rest of the lads. We were up mountain. Saw God. Heard his voice. Saw Moses and Elijah. Can't tell you. I got a secret you don't know. And on one level, it will start getting to you because there'll be this, maybe I'm somebody. I mean, that is a moment. You think, for them, Old Testament times, the whole story of Moses up a mountain, that would have been registering with them. The moments of Elijah was there. Do you know, that's going to make you think, maybe we are a little bit tad special. Yeah? And it starts getting to you. So you can imagine the argument along the road by this time. The insipidness of the doubts and the lack of who I am. And a lot of it's actually born out of fragile identity already. I've already got a fragile identity. I already don't think very much of myself. Well, thanks, really. That's really, really reinforced that. If I couldn't go up with the other two. You can imagine for Peter just for a minute. Fisherman to suddenly hearing God's voice and seeing Moses and Elijah. Come on. It's big stuff. And then you could see how that would start working into your thinking of maybe I'm special and the other thinking we're not. So the argument's along the road. Who is the greatest? So Peter giving it, well, clearly me and John. Yeah, we are, aren't we? Jesus chose us to go up the mountain, not you lot. Yeah? Got John giving it, well, I rest on Jesus' chest. I'm his bestie bud. So clearly I'm one of the greatest as well. Yeah? And you've got the other goes, no, yeah, but I do this. And I've cast out at least 20 demons. You've only done two. I've done all this healing over here. I filled 50 people when we're on the walk out. You've done zero. But you could imagine, I'm just trying to work through the argument of how the thinking can come about. Let's pull it into us today, shall we? Why can't I do what that person does? Why can't I lead worship the way that Timmy does? Why can't I have a singing voice like Denzel? Oh, does God favour them over me? No. Why can't I be as smartly dressed as Pastor Warren? Well, you know, what can I say? Why can't I have an immense amount of humility like Pastor Warren? So anyway, the... I'm being deliberately silly. I'm wearing all black today because it's hiding the immense food I had yesterday. It's doing well. What? Actually, I could. No, won't do that. But do we seriously think like that sometimes when we look around our fellow brothers and sisters? Why am I not in leadership? Be grateful. I'm being serious. For a starter, if I'm honest with you, being in, I'm not complaining, this is just a statement of fact, but it makes it very clear in the Bible, those that are teachers, high, leaders, whatever, will be judged more harshly. By the way, not teachers of primary school and colleges and high school. The government's already doing that for you already, don't worry about that. But those of us who are teachers and prayers and people who are in leadership of some nature, actually we're judged more harshly by God. So go, amen.
Amen.
No. But it's true. So, you know, don't sit there and think it's all great and roses, because you see us for the grand total of about 3 hours here on a Sunday morning. But what I'm trying to get at is that insipid thinking can get to us. Look at the responsibility that Peter was going to have to take. He had that moment on the mountain, but look at later on. Upon you, I'm going to build my church. And look at in Acts what Peter had to go through. The character refining that had to happen. Who would like that? Oh, that's a bit more subtle. The character refining I've had to go through before I could go into ministry. Believe you me, Joy was going amen. What I'm trying to get at is, this is such about relationships within the disciples here. It's relationships within churches. We have to be very careful that we don't look jealously at somebody else or negatively, because that's how you get the arguments on the journey. Now, I'm not saying we're in the midst of that now, I hasten to add, but it's a good thing for us to be on our guard about at all times. Be very cautious that you're not looking at somebody else and saying, do you know, I wished I could clean up in that kitchen the way that so-and-so does. I wished I could. I'm terrible. I've missed bits and dirt. Believe me, it's a gift. Hear me carefully. I keep saying this. Doing hospitality, tea and coffee rapidly out of that kitchen and making it taste really good is a genuine gift. One to be jealous of, but not, because we shouldn't be jealous. Each and every one of us has our role to play within God's kingdom. Amen? And just because some of us are a little bit more prominent than others, trust me, doesn't mean that that person is better in God's sight than the other person, because they're not. We're all equal in God's sight. We all just have a different role to play. Elsewhere in the Bible, doesn't it say when the Pharisees laughed to pray on the corners for everybody to see, well, they got their reward from the human eyes. It don't mean much, but that's what their reward's been, because that's fleeting. The reward is the ones that are done behind the scenes that the Father sees done on the quiet. So here we go. So then Jesus says, what were you discussing out on the road? No wonder they've probably gone, oh, Struth, he heard us. Oh, goodness me. I can't deal with another telling off. I'm not going to say a word. Because they probably knew at that point they really shouldn't have been arguing about it. And they clearly hadn't come to a resolution, because Jesus wouldn't have bothered asking the question, would he? Because if one of them would tell me, I'd say, look, lads, actually, do you know something? Nobody's the greatest. We've all got to be a servant of each other. Jesus wouldn't even ask a question. He'd be going, well done, you got it right. But they didn't. Whoever wants to be first must take last place and be the servant of everyone else. Now we know the answer, and we know that's the right answer. Living it out seems to be the problem, doesn't it? But that's the answer. We must become last in ourselves. In other words, it's not about me. It doesn't mean you don't look after yourself. It doesn't mean that you don't care for your body. It does not mean that you can turn around to somebody and say, no, I'm sorry, I can't help you because I am got other things to do, I'm exhausted, I've already booked in. You see what I mean? People sometimes take it too far and then run themselves ragged and into the ground and drive themselves so in the ground, they're then useless for anybody for months on end. That's not what it's about. It's about in your heart. Is it about me? Or is it about that person being lifted up and them could be coming before me? And how does he illustrate that? Takes a child and sticks them in his arms, which is amazing. Jesus was actually cuddling a child. Which we just go, oh, well, yeah, that's what we expect Jesus to do. But they didn't, because a child is nothing, didn't exist, is not there. Really is useless in their society. So then to take this child into the arms and say, anyone who welcomes a little child like this on my behalf welcomes me. If you welcome this nothing child here, that you consider nothing, into my arms, into your arms, into society, you've welcomed me. You have done the servant thing. We was at a ceremony yesterday, which was interesting for me because it was a weaning ceremony. It was for effectively a 6-month-year-old going to get given their first solid food. It's a Nepalese custom, and they were going to be given their first solid food. This was a big deal. A big deal for the community. Something like 285 people were present for this moment. And there was entertainment, there was dance, there was congratulating the parents and the child. Child's going to know nothing about what happened. But a big deal was put on for the child. That's how important. And it's the same thing. You put a big deal on for the person next to you, you've made them first, and you've become their servant. Honestly, it was glorious. Big white sofa, it was amazing, dude. And you sat there and you thought, wow, all this for the child getting its first solid food. If we thought about that for each and every one of us in this room today, or our neighbours next door to us, if we served them in that manner, what amazing different society we would probably be living in. Jesus calls us to do, not put on a party every weekend, but he calls us to welcome people who probably think they're nothing, and to welcome and honour them like they're something. That's what it means to be the greatest. Let's carry on. Verse 38. John said to Jesus, "Teacher, we saw someone using your name to cast out demons, but we told him to stop because he wasn't in our group." You get a feeling that John was trying to go for a distracting moment at this moment. Ah, okay, we didn't get that right, but we got this one right. We stopped this bloke casting out demons because he's not in our little group. He was an outsider. We had to stop him, clearly. What's our equivalent? We had to stop him, Lord, praying. He's not part of our denomination. He's a Methodist. I'm not slating the Meths. I am using them as an example. I was at an ecumenical across prayer breakfast. Funny enough, I've been felt instigated to do. And it's brilliant. So there was a representation from the Anglican, Catholic, Methodist and myself, for now, within the Greenford region. And we had a fantastic discussion. And what's the one thing we all truly believe? Jesus died on the cross, rose again. Everybody needs to come to know him. So imagine that. I can imagine this sense of, oh, but they don't come from our church. Stop them. So can you imagine John's going, we did that one right, didn't we? And then you get, don't stop him, says Jesus. You can imagine John going, oh no, I got it wrong again. No one who performs a miracle in my name will soon be able to speak evil of me. Anyone who is not against us is for us. If anyone gives you even a cup of water because you belong to the Messiah, hear this very carefully. If anyone gives you a cup of coffee because you belong to me, Jesus. There you go. Oh, no, no, coffee. No, you can't. He's allergic to coffee. Coffee. If anyone gives you a cup of coffee because you belong to me, I tell you the truth, that person will surely be rewarded. I'm sorted. I gave him a cup of coffee. I need to finish it off. Give it back. Cheers. Do you see the difference? But if you cause one of these little ones who trust in me to fall into sin, it will be better for you to be thrown into the sea with a large millstone hung around your neck. Why did you stop him doing something in my name just because he wasn't in our little cliquey group? Really? They're doing it in my name. It means they know about me. It means they clearly believe in me. So therefore then, and he's obviously not doing it to gain his own personal reward because he's announcing it in Jesus' name. Yeah? You got it wrong. Just because that person's not within our church doesn't mean they don't know Jesus. I'm just expanding it slightly. Now we're all sitting and go, yeah, we get that. We understand that. But I still hear people say things. Oh, yeah, well, they're part of the what's it denomination. Oh, they go to the Catholic Church. So? They're still Christians, you know. Give them a cup of coffee. Not because you want to be blessed, but because they happen to belong to Jesus. So if somebody who's not a Christian yet supposedly gives you a cup of coffee, it means you've been welcomed in when they know that you're a Christian. We were at this event last night. It was clearly evident, whom invited us know that we're Christians. And actually, while we was there, it was clearly evident that we were Christians. And therefore then, but we were made so welcome, you just think, well, they're not against us, are they? We just assume the whole of society is against Christians. That's not true. Anyway, but he's saying, don't cause this one to sin now. This person is actually being a humble person and calling things down in my name of Jesus. But you've actually made him stumble. You made him question it. Better for you to have a millstone hung. By the way, the millstone was what the donkeys pulled around to grind. It was a big thing. Put it this way, if you had that hung running napped and chucked into the sea, there would be no getting out. This next section is called hyperbole. It means it's sort of a sense of exaggeration, but the idea of it is actually to show the importance of something. So let's just go through it quickly. If your hand causes you to sin, cut it off. It's better to enter eternal life with only one hand than to go into the unquenchable fires of hell with two hands. If your foot causes you to sin, repeat after me, cut it off. It's better to enter eternal life with only one foot than to be thrown into hell with two feet. And if your eye causes you to sin, gouge it out. It's better to enter the kingdom of God with only one eye than to have two eyes and be thrown into hell, where the maggots never die and the fire never goes out. Feeling warm and fuzzy round about now? We talk about the love of God and the love of Christ and our identity in him and who we are, and that's absolutely right. But there is another side to it. There is another side of not following Jesus. It's judgment, being cast into hell, whatever your understanding of hell is, whether it's you will be forever burning fire flames for all eternity, or it's eternity separated from God. Either way, it's bad enough. This unquenchable fire, the imagery that was being taken by Jesus, was in a place called Gehenna, where basically for years before sort of the Jews, it was a place where child sacrifices took place. It was lots of sacrifices. And then it turned eventually by this time into a rubbish dump where just constantly it was always on fire. Because you chuck more and more rubbish on, and it just kept going, and it was not a place, it stank, it was not a place to go to. Anybody been to the recycling centre in Greenford recently? It's not the most smelliest, nice aroma in the world, is it? So imagine that 1,000 times worse. What's the whole statement of that? Well, if your right hand causes you to sin, cut it off. Could you hold up your hand? Could you hold up your hand? Now look at your hand. Imagine it not there. No, just seriously. Imagine it not there. This is my writing hand. This is my predominant hand, this is my most dominant hand, this is what I use the most. If you're left-handed, stick up your left hand like Denzel's shaking her head at. So stick up your left, no, if you're left-handed, stick up your left hand. If you're right-handed, stick up your right hand. Good. Okay. If you're ambidextrous, get out the building. Thanks, sit down, yes, good. Thanks for coming. Okay, so imagine, Denzel, stick up both hands and get them both cut off, right. But imagine that no longer there, your predominant hand, the very thing. You're going to say, I always want this hand. I know it also. It does some good. It does some great things. It helps me to write. It holds my coffee cup. It's what I use to cook with. It's the most prominent hand that I might affectionately touch somebody with. It's the hand that does a lot of good. But it also could be a hand that sometimes gets involved in sin. Yeah? Jesus saying, well, better off just cut it off. So imagine that no longer there. How would your life feel with it no longer there? Very difficult. But this is what Jesus is getting at here. It's no good hanging on to a sin in your life because everything else around it is good. If it's something that's at the core that's wrong, that you enjoy, you've got to cut it off. This is what the seriousness of this is. He's saying, look, sin is serious. You can't muck about with it. You can't play around with it. You can't try and subdue it or try and give it up for a little bit. You've got to make a radical, to use an imagery of a, you've got to make radical surgery on it and cut it off and cut it dead. Don't dabble with it anymore. Don't try and play with it. Don't go, do you know, I'm going to go on a sabbatical from it for a little while and then come back to it. Cut it off. Sin is serious. Amen?
Amen.
Don't like the idea of sin, but it's serious. This is why he's using hyperbole. He's clearly not saying, go, yeah, go cut your hand off. But he's saying it's that serious. To use Hendrickson, who I literally wrote out, he said, the surgery must be radical. Right at this very moment, and without any doubt, the obscene book should be burned, the scandalous picture destroyed, the soul-destroying film condemned, the sinister yet very intimate social tie broken, and the baneful habit discarded. In the struggle against sin, the believer must fight hard. Shadow boxing will never do. We talk about we have to stand against the enemy. That's true, but sometimes sin in our life is our enemy. There's maybe one particular one that's constantly at the go, and it is the worm, as that imagery, that never dies. It's forever. Have you ever seen a worm? It just constantly, in that imagery there, it's clear it's a worm that's going through corpses, or a maggot that's going through a corpse. It never dies because it's constantly got this rotting flesh it can keep eating on. Yeah? Yeah, good phrasing.
Lovely.
Yeah, right? But hang on a minute, that's what sin's like. It is rotting flesh that's within you. It's a rotting spirituality that's in you that actually the maggot of it never dies until you learn to cut it off. And you don't do it in your power. I don't do it in my power. We do it in the power of Jesus Christ. Amen?
Amen.
But we have to give it to him. And say, here is my maggot. Notice the imagery. Here is my maggot, oh big, powerful, awesome, authority God. Can you deal with it, please? Here is my maggot. It's this small compared to what Jesus is big or how big God is. It's that small. But somehow we make it like a whopping great whale and think, well, I'm never going to get rid of it. You're right. You aren't. But God is. If you give it to him. But we have to give it to him with a sense of, this is radical surgery I want you to do. I want you to cut this out of my life. I no longer want it. I've had enough of it. It is eating away at me constantly. It's rotting at my flesh on a constant basis. God, cut it off. And funny enough, just to use that, that's how we probably feel of the idea. I'm talking about the child going out screaming. No, I'm being serious. That's how we probably feel. No, no, don't take my toy away from me. I like that maggot. I understand that maggot. That means I actually have no more excuses left. Don't take it away. When I had to quit smoking, when God made it very, very clear to me, by the way, if you do smoke here, this is not a condemnation quote at you, hear me very carefully. I smoked for like the first 7 years of my Christian walk, okay? But when God finally went, you got to cut it off, get rid of it, I was like, no, no, inside I was screaming, it's okay. But the idea of suddenly seeing a radical change in my social life, a radical change in my habits, was scary. Was scary. I enjoy going out every hour with my work colleagues, going round the back of the car park and sparking up and having a good old chat and a chin wag. It was a great social thing. It's a great social thing to get an excuse to get out of the flat so Joy didn't nag me to do some housework. But what did I do? Gosh, the first thing I ever used to do when we walk into a pub to meet our friends, walk up, order the pint, first thing I'd do, pull out, spark up. It was habit. But it was wrong. It was no good. Smoking, by the way, all it does is make your clothes stink, ruins your health, and damages your bank balance. There is no good in it. It is the maggot that never dies. Don't tell me it makes you calm down. It doesn't. That's complete rubbish, by the way. It's habits, what you formed in your mind that you think it does. And I talk as an ex-smoker, and I'm not one of these people that's, I don't smoke anymore. I don't bother. It doesn't worry me being around people that smoke. But I'm just telling you, I know what was going in me when I was asked to cut that one out. That was 17 years ago now. Wow. I don't know what happened to the money. There's no extra in the bank balance. I don't understand that at all. No, not her. No, no. There's extra chocolate bars in Joy's pantry, but I don't understand. Anyway. But this is what I'm getting at. And sometimes actually asking God to radically cut something out feels painful. But it's the best thing that you can do. Because as it states here, at the end, for everyone will be tested with fire. By the way, the real probably reading is that everybody will be salted with fire. What? How do you get salted with fire? Well, salt is a preservative, is it not? Salt, for then, kept all the food good and clean and right and proper. A maggot doesn't. And actually, when it's salted with fire, fire is something that burns things off, burns off the chaff, burns off the wrong things. And so what comes out of a fire? Something pure. Salt is good for seasoning, but if it loses its flavour, how do you make it salted again? You must have the qualities of salt among yourselves and live in peace with each other. Notice how Jesus rounds it up. Stop arguing about who's the greatest. Serve one another. You can live at peace with one another. Get rid of that maggot thinking that's going on in your mind. Get rid of that maggot sin. Cut it off. Stop playing with it. Stop making excuses with it. Cut it off. Make that decision to get rid of it. It's going to hurt. By the way, when you put salt in a wound, anybody ever done that? It hurts, doesn't it? But you know, it's actually quite good for a wound as well. Ultimately. Same thing. Cut it off. So the three things from today for me. Don't be afraid to ask Jesus the question, just because you might be afraid of the answer. Ask him. Second thing, we must learn to put ourselves aside and be a servant to everyone. Servant, by the way, doesn't mean doormat. And the third thing, if there is a maggot in your life that's eating away at your flesh, at your spirit, at your emotional well-being, at your walk with Christ, because you know it's the thing that you're trying to hide from him, ask him to surgically remove it. Stick it on a hook and stick it in the sea. Let it eat some fish in there. Let it be ate by fish. Give me a few moments just to pray. Lord, Heavenly Father, I thank you for your word. I thank you for the examples the disciples were of the rest of us, fallen human beings, not always getting it right. But Lord, you still loved them. You still walked with them. You still cared for them. And most importantly, you still died for them and for us. Lord, I ask for each and every one of us that we continue in our walk with you with humility our walk with our fellow humans in humility. Teach us how to serve. And Lord, also I ask, in regards to the maggots, the maggot of sin that anybody here might well be struggling with now, Lord, I want to pray that you will help them to cut it out, to cut it off, to chuck it into the sea. To use a slight analogy on what Denzel said 2 weeks ago or last week, not to go fishing again for it. Lord, help each of us to walk humbly with you. In resurrection power. In the name of Jesus. Amen.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching videos at gbcweb.tv.